So liquidation preference, again very important. Typically, you know, these are the actual legal terms what you would see on liquidation preference, right? If, whether you understand or you don't understand, let it be, but this is really, really very complex. Let me try to simplify this, what it says. So typically, liquidation preference is the preference given to investor whenever the liquidation event occurs in the company in terms of merger acquisition, or maybe some new investor is coming on board, or maybe company is not really doing well and cannot move further, not able to raise next round of funding, and you decide to wind up. Right? So there are certain assets in your company which you are going to sell off. Typically, you know, you have some furniture, fixtures, computers, etc. So what happens is at the time of liquidation preference. So the earlier slide where you know those jargons were mentioned. So this is what it says: upon occurrence of liquidation event, investors are entitled to liquidation preference over the other shareholders, typically the promoters. The investment made by investor plus any unpaid dividends. Amount of assets in proportion of their shareholding. An investor will have no liability whatsoever. Right? This is what was mentioned in the earlier slide, those legal terms. What it means, let me try to simplify this. The first statement, it says, when and if you sell your company, you will pay us first before you guys think. You pay us what we have invested and also clear our outstanding dividends. Plus pay us amount received on sale of assets in proportion of our shareholding. All payables, liabilities are on you guys. You pay from your share of liquidation. Very simple, plain English language. This is what liquidation event talks about.
The original investment is the
most unfair part of it, right? There are liquidation preference which entrepreneurs are signing, which is 2x, 3x of the money which is invested.
Oh, okay.
Are you hearing me?
Yeah.
2x, 3x of the money invested.
Okay. So,
for example, irrespective of my shareholding, I might be holding 10%. If you have signed a 5x liquidation preference, let's say whatever exit comes in, my money into 5 is what you need to pay me, irrespective of my shareholding. Then whatever is left across,
it's a negotiable.
No, the idea is this is what entrepreneurs and investors agree upon. As the rounds grow, the liquidation preference is.
Investors insist on and entrepreneurs agree upon.
So life is unfair. So don't talk about fair and unfair. Idea is understand.
No. So it's not equitable. It's a negotiable.
Yeah, it's a negotiation. It's a negotiation. Right. You are not forced to sign anything.
No, my question was, is it equitable? It's not equitable.
The 3x, 5x comes into which document? In the term sheet or shareholder?
The term sheet is just an intent. So this is not in shareholder.
Shareholder secretary.
So term sheet, it will be written across. We are all agreeing, saying that between both, this is what is going to happen.
5x also comes into the SHL, right? Yeah.
So that 5x part, what he was talking about, is part of term sheet also, right? But not
elaborated.
It's a simple terminology. It is mentioned there.
Right?
Remember, the what are terms and conditions and clauses which are mentioned in your term sheet will reflect on your shareholders. Yeah, anybody else?
The terms won't change, right? Once the term sheet has been signed.
No, terms will change. Ideally, as Anand said, right? This is an intent, not a final binding. Ideally, as we move along, so for example, let's say when we discuss and do the due diligence, there is a huge difference. Earlier I had agreed to a valuation, now I want to down round it because I find there is a gap.
Or you have got an alternate term sheet, you come back saying that, hey boss, I want a better valuation. I've got an alternate term sheet now. It works both the ways. It's not something which is hard coded, saying that this is
how it's done. As a part of due diligence process, report comes saying that there is a huge liability on the company, right, which needs to be paid up. Or which may you may have to clear it down the line after certain period, right? Now, why investor would take up those liabilities on his end?
So
and how you are going to take care?
Anytime, whenever there is a word loan, right, everything gets converted into equity. मेरे पैसे से लोन रिपेंड नहीं होगा. As an investor, I want money to go into the company. If there are any loans, typically no investor will agree to pay off that. Or worst come you negotiate and you are like hardcore negotiator and you got option, you are a rock star entrepreneur. You may end up saying that whenever I earn money or I am profitable, I will repay this. Utna flexibility shayad investor de de. But more or less loans get converted into equity.
So typically loan converting into equity. The next question comes, if you have taken loans from your immediate family, father, mother, brother, sister, what if some outsider, some third party, right? Are you ready to give away equity? And is he ready to take equity against loan? Right? So a lot of questions there.
Basically, it's only bad, worse and worst.
Yeah.
Which is fine.
Right. So this is what is.
So you have chosen that path.
Yeah.
As an entrepreneur,
you should be happy with that.
Yeah. Whether it's bad or ugly and good, it's all about how you perceive across.
Yeah. Ideally, this versus reward ratio which comes into play.
Yeah. See, end of the day, investor sits on top of the market, right? He is evaluating so many deals. I mean, he has got options, right? So saying that. So still quality deals where investors are chasing are little rare in India. It's happening. I'm not telling it's not happening, but still we are not seeing saying that every entrepreneur coming out with a rock star opportunity is able to get 2-3 term sheets. I don't see that really happening across.
So next clause you would see is anti-dilution. Again, this is the actual legal terminology what you would see on your term sheet, right? Let me try to simplify this. So what the previous slide said that the founders shall procure that the company does not issue any shares below the investor price of acquisition per share at the time of investment. So you have the investor has invested, say 1,000 rupees per share in your company. Yeah. Except in ESOP. If the company carries out an allotment of shares to any person other than the investor at a price that is less than the acquisition price. So if you are able to find another investor who is ready to put in money, but he says that I'll pay only 500 rupees per share, not 1,000 rupees per share. The previous investor had paid 1,000 rupees per share. The company shall allot to the investor such additional number of shares in a manner as determined in accordance with the broad-based weighted average anti-dilution formula. So this is one anti-dilution formula which is given in your shareholders agreement, and based on that you have to give additional shares to the investor. If you decide to give new equity to another investor at price lower than the earlier investor.
Anti-dilution only applies in case of down round. Is that correct? True statement? Anti-dilution only applies in case of a down round.
So earlier we had a fully diluted.
Exactly.
What was the alternate?
This is the exception to the rule.
Non-dilutable. And now this is anti. Non-anti, small words.
So let's try to simplify this further. What it says is, you guys are not supposed to issue new shares below price what we have paid for. We love your employees and they have done a great job. So even if you are giving ESOPs to your employees as a part of your ESOP pool at lower price, I'm fine with that. You can issue shares below price to us, we don't mind, but not to anyone else. Mujhe de do chalega. Why you are giving it to outsiders? Right? And if you do so, you will compensate us by additional shares to match up the share per share cost to the new price.
But what in case of he is not ready to invest at a lower price again in the second round?
No, this you just give him three shares.
Three shares.
You manage this price. So if he's
earlier,
not last one, third point I'm not.
Maybe.
Yeah, no, that's
what I do.
So suppose the company needs money and we need to
that's a down round.
It's a down round.
So I mean they are saying you need not to give it to anybody.
The idea is if I want to participate in down round, I would do that. Okay. But if you have signed an entity dilution, if you are giving somebody a share at a lower price than what you had issued me, then you will have to give me
shares. That's all.
Basically, bring my price down to the same.
Same price. So I get an average, which is actually the last round. That's where anti dilution comes out.
Another important clause you would see is drag along. This is what actual legal terminology you would see across on any term sheet. Wordings and numbers may not remain as it is, but so let's try to simplify this. What it says is, in the event that even after completion of 12 months from the expiry of 5 years, no exits have been provided to the investors, neither the company nor founder purchased the investor shares as offered to them, the investor will have the unilateral right to sell their shares to any third party. So typically any term sheet or SHA you sign, investor would say that you will put in, you will provide required exits to the investors down the line after 3 years, 5 years, whatever. Right? That time frame is agreed between two parties. If you are unable to do this, then what? So that is what this drag along statement talks about. If third party requires additional shares, then upon a decision of the holders of 75%, again this percentage depending on how you have agreed upon, more of the shareholders of investor share, the investor shall have right to drag along and require all the founders to sell some of their shares, blah 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 blah. Let's try to simplify this. Either providers exit within 6 years from the investment date, or you guys or company buy back our shares. If this doesn't happen, then we have no choice but to sell this shares, our shares, to any outsider third party. So if you are not able to find alternate investor and help us to get exit, we may find on our own. If third party demand even 100% or less equity, so that less than you, so investor is holding 20%, right? And promoters are holding 80%. If this third party says that I am ready to buy out, provided 50% of equity is transferred to me, or 100% equity, that is entire company is transferred to me, right? Investor has right to drag you guys, the promoters, as well as other investors along with, and sell out the company.
At what price?
What are agreed prices there? It may be on positive note, negative note, whatever.
Yeah. But the price will have parity with the third party, will pay the same price to the investor as well as the promoter. There cannot be any disparity.
So there can be, it depends on, you know, how the finally deliver. See, remember at the time of this kind of, you know, final discussions, you are also party to that discussion. Right? So investor will come up with that offer that, okay, this is what offer is, but you guys have to give away the entire company, your 80% stake to the new company or new investor who is ready to invest. Or let's say 50%. He says that I need 50%. You guys are holding 20%. I need additional 30% from existing promoters, and let existing promoters continue with balance 50% and continue running this business. So that is a partial.
So a lot of this has got a lot of variability. For example, as an entrepreneur, you can ask across. This is entrepreneur's favor, right? If you can negotiate, think that you can the invoking of this dragon off can happen only if there is a 10x. You know, of the valuation journey or the value creation, then you can invoke. So you can prevent yourself saying that, you know, you don't want to give away cheese or that way. So there are various ways where you can tweak this on a variability. The idea is investor has got right to drag the founder for getting himself an exit. So mera 100 rupees jo laga hai aapki company mein, wo recover karne ke liye agar aapka company mein bechna pada, I will do that.
So you can put things like in this particular case, in a drag along course, your liquidation preference reduces.
Yeah, whatever. So you can play around with it, but again depends upon, see, at most of the times entrepreneurs are not in a position of power, and that's where this you know, it's like all these agreements of investor are like bidder agreements, right? This is what it is, buy it out. You know, leave it across. So there are very few things which can engage across, but the best way to engage with any investor is typically to ensure that your relationship with your investor is good enough, that you don't need to refer this document actually. If you are referring this document at every now and then, I think your business is in trouble, right? This document, once signed, should be kept, pushed, you know, closed. For me as an investor, if I am referring this document, then I have chosen the wrong entrepreneur.
Correct.
Works both the way. So, I tell you, yeah, go ahead.
So, you can have a right of first refusal before the drag along.
Okay, Kafi hai. That's why I said, let's try for the.
So, this drag along, it will only between the investor and the founder, in case of multiple investors.
Yeah, so multiple, that's why the 75% comes, right? Team party hai, to three party hai. As Vipul said, you know, you can put in whatever number, seven highest value investor number.
So
value
mean that you have, you are having only first set of investors, but what if you have two or three sets of investors?
Right.
So that's where the percentage and ranking can change.
So there can be 75% of the invested value in the company. There are multiple ways where you can structure this, but all this structuring typically happens by the investor. You know.
So what about a reverse drag along clause? Look at this way. Like for example, the person who is the founder member, he's making adequate profits, and he wants
next
to
time
buy,
tag along. Tag.
He wants to buy the founder's share.
Coming with
it. Tag along.
Fine. So protective provisions. Earlier slides, you know, we had a lot of discussion and debates on, you know, rights and, you know, when to go to investors, when I have to go and take approvals and things like that, right? So there might be, you know, so these are some of the list of items where investor would say that, okay, whenever you are doing any of this activities, you need my approval, you need my permissions, right? So such item, alteration in your company's articles, memorandum, change in share capital, creating new class of shares or securities. So that is typically when you are raising next round of funding, you are creating next another series just to differentiate between your existing investors and new investors, right? Liquidate, dissolve or wind up operations of the company, or you are selling the assets of the company. You are declaring and making payment of dividends. So these are some of the activities where investors would ask for this approval, right? right? Let's try to simplify what it says, that we are ready to extend our support to you, grow your business, but you will focus running your business if any of these listed actions are taking place, you would need our permissions, right? So the list of items what I have mentioned, very few items, but in reality, in the SHA, the complete bunch of activities where you would need investors' approvals. Condition precedence and timeline. So typically what happens is, the term sheets are given, right? And both of you have agreed to these term sheets, you have signed these term sheets, right? And the due diligence process starts, right? And the investor side consultant is going to check various parameters of your business in terms of your legal, finance, HR, internal processes, your liabilities, and so on. Right, and there is going to be an exhaustive list of activities. Probably you have not maintained, you have not performed. Maybe your employee agreements are not in place. Right, the software developers who are building your IP. Right, you don't have non-disclosures and non-compete agreements with them. Even agreements within your founding teams, your friend you have started business with them. Right, as a co-founder, initially you have not done any documentations, right? So all such gaps, investor would ask you to fill up before the money comes into your company's account, right? So there are going to be certain items where investor would say that you have to complete this, till that time you don't show me the final result, I'm not going to put in money. There are going to be certain items where investor would say that, okay, you just give me a declaration that you are going to complete these activities within next 45 days. Give me in writing and then we are ready to move ahead. There are certain activities which you need to complete from compliances point of view. So let's say you are going to give away some equity to your investors. So you need to have required authorized capital registered with ROC. So if this authorized capital itself is not there, or if you have not increased your authorized capital, how you are going to issue equity to your investors? So such action points becomes a part of condition precedence, right, which you have to complete before the investor's money comes into your account. So the subscription by investor is subject to fulfillment of the condition precedence, satisfactory completion of legal and financial due diligence, resolutions to any material issues which may arise out of due diligence. So let's say at the time of due diligence, there is a loan, outstanding loan in your brother's name. Now what you are going to do? Are you going to repay? Then first you repay. How you repay, that's your problem. This loan should not be visible on your balance sheet. Right? So either you repay this loan or you convert this loan into equity. Now this has to be done before investor puts in money. So this becomes one of the major due diligence checklist point. Validity of accept and reject the term sheet. Typically one or two times you have. Right? So during this period, you have to complete the due diligence process, right, and complete the condition precedent actions. Exclusivity. So as initially he mentioned, during this two weeks period, the investor will have exclusivity here. You cannot take this term sheet to any other investor for better offers. So we are talking about due diligence, so let's see what kind of challenges we face up across. Complete in-depth checks on business, finance, taxation, compliances, HR, legal, sales, marketing, etc. All these areas of your business is going to get checked. Even if you have some paying customers, let's say, right, what kind of agreements do you have with your paying customers? So let me give you an example. Let's say one of your customers says that, okay, you will provide me complete source code, then only I'll buy this. And you have agreed. Because he is giving you something else. Now, such kind of agreements or such kind of commitments are not acceptable by investors. Major challenges. You don't have financials in up to date. Government taxes are not recorded or paid. Company employees appointment letters and NDAs, non-compete agreements are not in place. ROC compliances, record maintenance, audit, tax returns filing is not done or incomplete. Outstanding demands of interest and penalties from any of these government regulatories like ADS, service tax, VAT and so on. Customer orders and agreements are not in order. Maybe you just have customer's email commitment, or you don't have even email commitment, and you are, you have started exhibiting services, or you have given away subscription or product licenses or whatever. There is outstanding loans in books. So these are some of the challenges what you face up across at the time of due diligence, and investor would ask you to fix up this first before he puts in money. And at that point of time, you have only 15 days to complete this due diligence process and fulfill this condition precedent requirement so that money comes into your pocket.
So I'll just share across. I mean, typically, while we expect across entrepreneurs to be ready and doing in 2-3 weeks' time, if there is a gap, typically it's okay. It works bilaterally. Only thing is, money into the bank will get delayed. It's in best interest to quickly close all this required formalities, because you are delaying your own money which you want across. So better to be compliant, better to be investable, right? Saying that you are ready to take in investment. So there have been places where me as a lead investor had a huge struggle in terms of closing this whole set of documents with the entrepreneur. While his product was phenomenally good, the books were in shambles, right? So it didn't really. So, and many times you find across people, as much they do innovation on product, they try to innovate on legal and compliance. Become more and more challenges. So your reputation suddenly takes a beating. There is a huge amount of innovation we see in legal and finance. So try to keep yourself aligned to what is subscribed as a legal compliance in all the aspects.
So in short, you don't do innovation on the finance or legal and compliance side.
And many times entrepreneurs will sab kuch mai kar raha hu, investor kya kar raha, right? Because a lot of work is there, everything is coming back to entrepreneur. That's where the perseverance and tenacity of entrepreneur is to do all this stuff. I'm a great techie, but why do I need to learn all this? Right? Why do I need to learn finance? How do I manage cap tables? Why should I learn all this? Now, this is where this is developing you into a successful, entrepreneur. This is your steps. If you think this is not something which is your cup of tea, you want to shy away, it's not going to help.
So I've seen examples where before investor comes on board and company has managed to, or promoters have put in their own hard earned money from or taken loans from family and friends, right? And there are a lot of actions taken or not taken which is creating a major hurdle at the time of investment. So let's say taken some small office on rent and paying 25,000 rupees kind of rent every month without deducting TDS, right? And suddenly, one find when due diligence process starts and says that, okay, you have not paid TDS, which you are liable to pay, right? And now you have to pay this TDS out of, because you have already paid that entire money to the landlord. And now you have to pay this money, TDS, with interest, with penalty.
It is as much, he's doing all the observation. there is a lot of action which is happening across from the land. But from an entrepreneur perspective, you need to be continuously taking action, steps, right? If you don't move, nothing is going to move in your company. So as a founder, entrepreneur, promoter, you are expected to take actions.
So to continue on this, you have limited time, as I said, to complete the process and negotiate and execute the SHF. There are quite a lot of time, compliances activities to be performed during pre-funding and post-funding stages. Post-funding, it's time for executions. You have money now, you have to start taking required actions as per the commitments and business plan what you have with the investors. And regularly review and reporting to the investors. So this is what typically you would see across on any term sheets, right? And little bit more about my company, Tipping Point, I would like to mention here. So the startup entrepreneurs, as we mentioned, you guys are really great innovators. But when it comes to rest of the activities, at initial stage you face challenges, and that's where Tipping Point comes into picture. At starting stage, business processes, documentation, compliances, finance, taxation, regulatory matters are given the lowest priority, because your priority is to build a product, take it to the market, get investors on board, right? So this all areas are given the least priority. And one fine day when investor wants to come on board, that time it becomes a major challenge. And it starts impacting to your business growth. So we at Tipping Point, we understand this very well.